Now, an investigation that uncovered decades of sexual abuse at one of the nation's elite private preparatory schools and the extent to which the school hushed it up. Ari Sreenivasan has that story from our New York studios.
The report released last night focused on a dozen former teachers at the prestigious boarding school in Connecticut, Choate Rosemary Hall. It recounts the experiences of 24 adult alumni who were allegedly abused between 1963 and 2010. Investigators said the offenses range from kissing to groping to rape. Choate hired a law firm with no previous ties to the school to lead the investigation. Jonathan Saltzman was part of the Boston Globe spotlight team that helped break the story. And Paul Mones is an attorney who has represented sexual abuse survivors at private schools and other institutions. He is not involved in any of the Choate cases. Jonathan, I want to start with you. You and your team launched this series a while back about this happening at elite prep schools in the Northeast. What did this report reveal to you?
Well, we had reported on about 110 private schools in New England that had faced allegations of sexual abuse over the past 25 years. And we mentioned Choate, but this report was initiated in response to that story. And it laid out in extremely graphic detail the accounts of about 24 survivors of abuse. And as you said in your introduction, some of these are extraordinarily graphic descriptions of abuse, rape. And to me, the most startling thing about the report was that first, the school named 12 teachers that they said had abused kids. That's an extraordinary number, and we haven't seen that before in other schools. And then what they also did was they essentially owned up to the fact that they had never reported these cases of abuse to child welfare authorities in Connecticut, even though it had been required.
You know, there's an incident that was mentioned in the report of what would likely qualify as at least attempted rape that happened in a swimming pool on a field trip in Costa Rica. But the headmaster's report to the Board of Trustees essentially labeled it, pointed to heavy drinking and inappropriate behavior. And then we find out that the teacher in question was still employed as a principal at a different school until last week.
That's right. Choate got in touch with that public school in Litchfield, Connecticut, very recently, and I spoke to a lawyer for that school district in Litchfield last night, and they said that they had that when this teacher applied, he used a slight variation of his name, and that he never mentioned that he'd worked at Choate. And that's a running theme that we found in a number of our stories, this whole passing the trash syndrome, right, which is that schools let teachers go quietly, they hush it up, and the teachers resurface somewhere else.
What I found particularly, if I could just comment quickly, and particularly interesting is that the school only acted after the Boston Globe story. They would have been comfortable sitting on their hands for if the Boston Globe did not call. And this is typical of the behavior of large institutions wherein sexual abuse happens among their ranks. And so they followed the same pattern as the Catholic Church. There was one interesting part of the report, in fact, where in the summer of 2012, or 2002, I'm sorry, it was reported that they received reports that a teacher had molested a student. They called that teacher back to the school and basically let this teacher quietly leave. In fact, even say, and I'm sure you remember this, where the teacher then would get a recommendation to go work at a boys' school. You have to remember that the Boston Globe stories on the Catholic Church, where this identical behavior was happening, was started the review of the criminal cases in January or February of 2002. And so it's not like this happened many years ago. Sometimes we say, oh, in the Boy Scout cases I've had or the church cases, oh, it was the 60s, it was the 70s. These are like super smart people in an elite institution, and you only have to believe they never read the New York Times or the Boston Globe or listened to the TV or had any knowledge whatsoever of sexual abuse to act in such an opprobrious way to the welfare of their children, even as late as 2002.
Paul, you know, you've taken on, or your clients have taken on, a lot of different types of institutions, and you've described child abuse as almost a perfect crime. Explain.
Right. It's a perfect crime because the victims remain silent. The perpetrators, we underestimate the perpetrators because these are very smart people. In the cases of private schools, we know that private schools survive, or they're best known for congeniality, conviviality, informal relationships, calling the teachers by their first name, coming over the teacher's house for studying, maybe for a glass of wine, the, you know, when the kid is 16, 15 or 16 years old. Mm-hmm. And so it's this breeding ground. But these people are very, these perpetrators are very smart, and they know how to take advantage of a place that doesn't have many boundaries.
John Saltzman, we asked Choate if they'd appear, and they said they would not, but they did send us a statement that says, "We profoundly apologize. The conduct of these adults violated the foundation of our community, the sacred trust between students and the adults charged with their care. We honor and thank the survivors of sexual misconduct who came forward." That's part of their statement. Considering that this report only goes till 2010, what's happening now at the school, and how are they trying to prevent this from happening again in the future?
Well, I mean, it's a good question. The school says that they are, they have heightened awareness about this, that in one of the cases they reported, there was one case that they reported to child welfare authorities, and this was in around 2010. They discuss greater training, things like that. And I should point out that some other attorneys that I spoke to who said agree with Paul that this is a litany of horribles did give the school credit for being as frank as they were in this mm-hmm. report. I spoke also to one of the alumni and who is the only one identified as being abused because she came forward to us. And she gave them credit for being as frank as they were. And I'll give you an example of how frank they are. This report, I've never seen this in another report from a school, has a label on the top of it saying that it contains graphic material and is not suitable reading for children. That's a pretty telling thing to put on a report.
Right. And I read that and I thought, really? You know, it was good enough to sweep under the rug, and I understand that, but I thought that I was turned off by that. I thought that, yes, it was that graphic, but now they're saying you have to have, keep it away from unwanted eyes. I viewed this as being the only reason, as I said, I have to reiterate this, if the Globe didn't come knocking, if there wasn't a rising march of voices of students from private schools yelling for relief, whether it's Horace Mann or schools, St. George School around the country, they would have done nothing at all.
All right, gentlemen, we'll see you on TV tonight. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thanks, Harry.
Bye-bye.